Nice to see you.
Sorry to get ahead of this thing.
Yeah, let me know what's in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, William, you used to live near?
I used to live in Shell River in Mississippi. That's where I was born.
Is it from Brandon?
1909.
Oh, yeah.
So, after that, we moved to right across here, my dad's homestead. And there,
yeah.
He farmed a little bit. And
cut wood.
Well, we cut wood in the winter time. In the summertime, we used to go and dig snagger roots. After that, we finished, we started to stoke.
I used to live with these guys.
Yeah.
Did you?
Yeah.
Used to do the stoking with trash. For $1.25 a day for 18 hours. And after we chop wood in the winter time and make trapping the same time.
Yeah.
And after when the time of the flu, they got the flu there, you know.
1918, was it?
19, yeah, somewhere there.
Yeah.
Dad lost his boys there, older than me, with the flu. So he sold the farm. He went to St. Lazare then.
Mm-hmm.
And we stayed in the Tsar there for 14 years, right beside the cemetery there. Took all his cattle. And he bought 4 lots in there, you know, he couldn't read that time in Central Tsar. When it comes to get it, and old John Selby sold it. You see, nobody could read or write, eh?
No.
So he got a cot there. After that, we live in, what they call it in Chinatown, 2 miles on the other side of the Tsar there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that worked there. And when we were in Central Tsar first, I was going to school. Well, in the winter. Well, in the winter, you know. And when I was 12 years old, I got kicked out to go to work. So I've been working since.
Yeah.
We were a ten of family, so he couldn't support us.
Yeah. So you didn't get to school?
Well, I went to grade 4 in 3 winters, just as I was learning fast. But I never read and write. Well, I can write a little bit, but never read. Never.
Did you go to St. Madeline's school ever?
No. I went to St. Lazar's school. And way up over here, there was a school here.
Yeah.
Gambler school, they used to call it. My sister used to carry me in his bag. I was only 5 years old. She's 89 years old. She's living in Burton.
I was
Brandon.
Out picking Saskatoon this morning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So after that, you know, when I got married in 40.
Uh-huh.
That's 50 years ago.
Yeah.
I went to work in a sheep ranch. I worked 6 years there, looking after 1,300 sheep. And my boss went away to Vancouver, he sold me the half section for $1,600 with the building and all,
yeah.
Everything. I farmed for a little while,
yeah.
And after that, well, I started to work on a good road. Before I left Lazar, I was driving a school bus.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I drove the transfer to Winnipeg for $2 a trip. What's up there? It's part of my land.
Oui, c'est ça. Et
Cree, aussi. Oui, Cree, je suis capable de parler tout. Oh oui, parle tout.
Et Michi? Le langue Cree est français?
Le français, mon père qui vient de Québec. Ma mère, c'est pas où. Elle a entouré, c'est marié, c'est après.
Combien d'enfants?
Oh, 4. J'ai 2 filles et 2 gars. Ils sont à Brandon. Deux, les deux fils ont travaillé dans le général. Puis mon gars, sa femme, est superviseur. Dennis Leclerc. Lui, il joue dans le patrouille, il travaille dans le style. Puis le plus vieux, c'était pas capable de rien faire avec. Il est en prison là. C'est ça. Il y a pour un femme, je pose, il y a Dieu. Il a insulté, il a le tué, un hein, autre sacré dedans.
Jovin, did you know Jovin?
Oh, I was raised with him.
Uh-huh.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jovin. That's the one I was saying this morning. They laugh at me, they laugh. Everybody laughs, you know. And he said, Jovin, he said, Alvina there, you know,
yeah.
They were never married.
Oh, uh-huh.
Right in St. Madeleine here, I was the best boy to Baptiste Bartier, he was married to. When I were dancing, 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, he lost his wife, he's lost sense to them.
Yeah.
His Jovin took away.
He's a pretty risky guy.
Well, the way, see, maybe he was related to him, huh? He had to do that to go for somebody else.
Yeah. Yeah.
when I was first married in 1940 there, you know, there was no work. I killed some rabbits and there were 40 sets of skin. Used to kill 200-300 of them a day. To make my living.
Yeah, yeah. Just snare them.
Yeah, snare them.
Yeah.
And chew them too, you know, I had 22. You know.
Why you remember when St. Madeline was a community?
Oh, well, they say, I remember we used to come to church here. The church was here one time, right in the cemetery there.
Yeah.
And That's where we used to come with the bishop from St. Lazare there. We used to drive there with the buggy and the wagon.
Yeah.
We had to come in there. Yeah. We used to be right across. All the Fleuries. Oh, yeah. Monk was a Fleury.
Oh.
All the Fleuries that were in here, the old time, that's what all his uncles.
Yeah. They're all buried over here now.
They're all buried here. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're all of them there.
Yeah.
So that's where that. That fine, his wife, when he came here, when dad lost his mother and dad when he was 4 years old, and his brother raised him, and they came, they was in St. Eustache, that's where he was.
Was that because of the flu?
Well, St. Eustache, that's why my dad was born, like, you know, long years ago.
Yeah.
And the St. Laurent there, he came there, he had a bunch of cattle. He was only 12 years old, so when they left St. Laurent, they got lost, they went by Brandon, they were going to Fort Ellis years ago, huh? Bring down here, over here, when he was small.
Yeah.
I don't remember that, but that's what he used to tell me.
Yeah,
huh?
Right.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful country.
Yeah, beautiful country.
Did you go to any of the dances in the school here, or any of the
get-togethers? Oh, yes. We used to go dancing. I used to come with my old model tea to go and dance. Yes, I said that. You had to push it up the hills. The bunch was not enough power.
Yeah.
And when you put the little brakes on, you know, the brakes, your light would go out the butt for magnet. They used to run with magnet, the lights.
How late did the dances go?
Oh, till 7 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
The sun was coming out.
Yeah.
We had to walk back 18 miles after. Sometimes we used to come on foot to St. Lazare.
Yeah. who played fiddle?
Oh, there was a Fleuries and Barmets and Bushies. And, you know, I used to play the violin myself.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I used to go in Brandon there. I used to go when that fellow, we were Lederoth, Eugene Lederoth.
Oh, yeah, I know Eugene, or I did. He's
yeah,
deceased.
Well, he's dead now.
Yeah.
Well, I used to go and call square dancers in university.
Really?
University there. You know?
Uh-huh.
But, yeah, you were doing with piano player. Do you? Avant hier ben je was een kaart la 21 cent piast. Ça golf les deux ça sans.
The old songs, Jovin.
Oh yeah, we used to sing French songs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know those old songs, William?
Oh, I forget them all.
Yeah.
I forget them all now. Yeah.
Yeah.
I used to sing too. You know, in the dances we used to have. Lunchtime, we all, you had to dance to eat your lunch because you wouldn't have it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
No, I forgot them all. It's funny, all my kids, they're all good singers.
Are they? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I left, quit my violin 15 years ago.
Oh, that's too bad.
I got it at home. After when my son, my daughter got married, well, I didn't play no more.
I bet you could still call the square dances, though.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
I still did.
The dance carry?
No, well, I used to do it. I used to go to St. Boniface, they called for a fair one time.
Yeah.
You know what it is today, like you and me, eh? We forgot our French, we want to talk English, because all my kids that understand, only the two of us don't understand French. Yeah, they're all English, the baby in the family.
Yeah.
What the hell are you talking about? He said, we're talking French, eh?
Uh-huh.
And then the old lady talks.
Yeah, yeah.
That's where it goes, eh?
Yeah,
yeah. But I like, they got a good job. They're making their own living, so I don't have to bother them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some of those old songs are gorgeous.
You know, I'm 81 years old and I haul scrap every day yet.
Really?
Yeah. The last time I was in the hospital, I stayed a month and a half. I went through 5 operations in my life.
Quel âge as-tu?
83 d'avril,
j'ai dit. Oh, Elvina's here.
Elvina, yeah.
And Cécile and
Cécile.
Vivian, are they here?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, they're all here, yeah.
Good.
Où est-ce que tu
Pardon?
Où est-ce que tu viens, va? Va, Brandon.
Oui, oui.
Otra está Brandon Tutsavi.
Oui, c'est ça. Brandon et Saskatchewan aussi.
Dans Saskatchewan?
Oui, les prairies.
Oh, où est-ce que ça? Quelle place que c'est ça?
Oh, mon Dieu, c'est près de Pearson, Kerryvale.
Oh, oui, oui, oui.
Okay,
we
no,
no, I guess we'll fit trash together. He came here and the old joiner would do it and call it. He was deaf as hell. And he was asking questions to laugh at him. I just told him today, see what
it all comes back to haunt you when you're
yeah, it
nasty.
I got it was green that was.
Are you ready to do another award?
Yep, yep.
Okay, it's Dell, isn't it?
I think so.
Should be here.
Of course, you look right up there.
Not here.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay, yes.
For you.
Mm-hmm.
All set?
Yeah.
Are you seeing lots of people you know here?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Does it bring back old memories?
Yes, yes. Wish we all were here in those little houses around us again. Yeah.
Where were you raised near here?
Yeah, where was the house? I don't remember where, but I don't remember the day I was born.
Yeah,
no, not
too far
from
the cemetery.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You sang that little song for me the other night, en français, en parlant français, n'est-ce pas?
Some, yeah, sometimes.
Tu peux chanter une chanson?
When? Right now?
Oui, oui, maintenant, avec
oui,
les mains.
Oui, ben oui, le bon,
oui,
okay. Avec la tête.
La tête, oui.
Avec la tête, oui.
Oui, vas-y.
Non?
Oui.
OK. Quand le bonhomme revient du bois, quand le bonhomme revient du bois, trouve la tête de son âme, et carillon, et carillonnette, tête pauvre tête. Quand le bonhomme revient du bois, quand le bonhomme revient du bois, trouve les pattes de son âme, et carillon, et carillonnette, pâte pauvre pâte. Quand le bonhomme revient du bois, quand le bonhomme revient du bois, trouve les bras de son âme, et carillon, et carillonnette. Quand le bonhomme revient du bois, quand le bonhomme revient du bois, trouve les ventes de son âme, et carillon, et carillonnette. Quand le bonhomme revient du bois, quand le bonhomme revient du bois, trouve les corps de son âme, et carillon, et carillonnette.
Did you go to the St. Madeline school here?
Yeah, for a while because there was no teacher. For a while we went there, and then it stopped. And
I talked to Annalie Dreilich one day. And she did you go with that? Or Rosalie, rather?
No. We're with Della Vermette. And wait, did you come with us? I think, I don't know who, there's a bunch of us anyway, but not.
Where did you go in Madeline?
We called it Boulevard School, I think. It was
Boulevard
Blowing, yeah. Boulevard School, and then that our teacher got sick and he quit for a while, and then you come back and this little boy drowned and you quit, that's when they shut the school, I think.
Yeah.
That's I remember.
And then this whole community was moved out.
Yeah.
And where did you move to?
We moved to St. Lazare that time.
Yeah. Some people moved to Selby
Town?
Yeah,
Selby Town and Ben's Car, the corner they call it, I don't know. So,
yeah,
Selby Town and the corner, it's different.
Not right now.
Yeah. And you've been in St. Lazare since?
Yeah.
I was surprised
to move to Brandon after, yeah. So I've been to Brandon about 22 years, I guess now.
Yeah. Where did you learn the French song?
Oh, my nephew, Josephine's son, Leonard Van.
Yeah.
My brother can sing French too. You can ask him later on today, Vincent.
He's here.
He was over there, but he didn't sing. He was playing pool.
Those
Bill Leclerc can sing French song too.
Oh,
so you have to get after all those things. Not only me. They can sing. They can talk.
It has to be late at night, though, when they're
dark.
Well, it doesn't have to be if you really talk to them.
And then they've got a bottle of Sprite in their hands.
But they won't be here with that.
No.
No, they don't. No, they might. Uh-huh. I don't need that. I had just a Sprite and a cup of tea and cool water before I come here. So.
And you did it.
I did. I saw this. Yeah, I did it.
Is there anything else that we should know about St. Madeline?
No, I've been doing this from somebody else, yeah. If you're going to talk with somebody else, it's different too. Maybe it's they remember more than I do. And, I know there's lots, I can say lots, but I don't have time. I don't remember. I have to look what I wrote down. I got 5 pages, but I don't think I can.
Yeah.
I have to look what it's because I don't remember so many things. And what I remember, I wrote down, but like,
yeah.
I have to make a book and
really should. Yeah, somebody should make a scrapbook.
All of us to remember and put it in a book. And
How about you, Josephine? Are you?
Wait.
We'll change.
We gotta change mics. Right,
well, thanks, Olivia. Do you have some memories of St. Madeline, Josephine?
Oh yeah, especially today now when I'm here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What years did you live? And I was asking about you lived in St. Madeline.
Mm-hmm. I was born in St. Madeline. Yeah.
How long ago was that?
Until they chased us out of here.
Mm-hmm. What year was that?
Mm-hmm. It's around 1939 or something like that, around somewhere around there.
Where did you go after that?
We moved by Bertle over there somewhere in the CPR house, I think it was.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And how did you make a living over there?
Oh, well, my husband was working for the farmer day, $5 a day.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was Joel.
Yeah.
And then he became a carpenter after?
After that, after we moved from there. We moved to Minnedosa, and that's where he started.
How did he learn?
On his own.
Did he read and write?
Well, he only went up to grade 2, but then he learned on his own by reading the books and the papers. And
he
was working for carpenters before. See, that's how come he learned, and then he went on his own later.
Yeah. And he could look at those complicated plans and just
figure
them all out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was pretty good at it. Yeah.
You went through the flu?
Pardon?
What year was that flu?
Oh, that was before. I can't remember that too much. No.
Yeah.
I remember, just like a dream that when the people were sick with the flu.
What was your family name?
My family name, Vermette.
Do you know, I phoned your son in Edmonton recently.
My son, which one?
I think it's Leonard.
Oh, he's here tonight.
I said, are you coming to Brandon? Who in the world I was.
Oh, yeah.
So I'll have to say hello to him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you know who your parents were, Josephine?
My parents, yeah.
Uh-huh.
August Vermette.
Uh-huh.
and Zelda Klein, her maiden name.
Oh, yes.
She was from around the Brett, my mother.
Oh, really? Yeah.
My dad came from Winnipeg, but he was married before, and but his wife died, and that was his second wife,
uh-huh.
My mom.
Yeah, from Saskatchewan. Mm-hmm. What did the women do back in those days when you were living
well,
here?
Well, yeah, my mother used to work in the cleaning that time, cleaning houses, and that's what she used to do.
Yeah.
And my dad was scrubbing and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I was at home babysitting, so I didn't go to school.
Yeah. How many children in the family?
There was about, well, there was only two after when I was babysitting.
Yeah.
But before that, there was four, but two of them died. There was a girl older than I am. She died when she was 14.
Yeah.
And one brother died.
Well, we'll take a few anyway.
I don't remember how old he was, though,
yeah,
when he died.
Not enough,
and after that, there was only Alvina and Vincent for a while that I babysat. And then after that, Alice was born. And
well, do you know any stories about the families or the Claires?
No, I don't know about the Claire. I remember Matt.
Uh huh. Yes. Yeah. Were you raised in this area?
No. I was born here too, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Some Madeleine. And I went to school here, but off and on.
How far did you walk to get to school?
I walked from where we used to live over there.
Mm-hmm.
A mile, half a mile.
Yeah. It'd be a beautiful walk.
Yeah.
Pasture.
I didn't even go to school that much, though. I didn't even pass my grade 2.
Why not?
I had to stay home and look after kids, and the cows and stuff like that. While my parents. I live with the Bilmers after my dad went to Saskatchewan.
Yeah.
And I was with them till I got married.
Yeah, yeah.
Got married in 1939.
Yeah.
So I know.
And where did you live then?
In Vinsford.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Not in town, but out of town. About 3 miles out.
Out of town.
For a while, then we moved into town.
How did you support yourselves in Vinscart?
Well, my husband used to work for farmers and that. I guess just about everybody used to do that work, that kind of work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So is my dad when we used to live here. He used to go and work for farmers. And when I was 15, I used to work for the Bushies. Joe Bushy used to live here, not far from here. I worked for them there for 3 years, $5 a month. But I used to get paid through the government.
I don't
remember what you call them.
Don't know what that would be. Is there ever any visiting on the gambler reserve there, or is there visiting back and forth?
At that time?
Yeah, well, between Gambler and St. Madeleine.
I suppose. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there used to be, I guess, older people, yeah, but I don't remember going to California.
All the Tanners.
I know we used to walk from here to Vinscart on Saturday night.
To go to a dance?
No, just to go to a town.
Uh-huh. helped, have you kept track of all the families and all the people that used to live here?
Oh, I...
They're all kind of disappeared.
Yeah. Like me and Lena Fleury.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We went around with Tenet and went one night to put signs where the people used to live, where they're gonna go with horse, a team of horses tomorrow and Sunday, I guess they will do that.
Yeah.
And last night I went with my nephew and Lena, me and Lena went again.
Mm-hmm.
This, on by the creek over there where Josephine is, her mom and dad used to live,
mm-hmm.
out that way, and different families.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
We put signs out there too.
Their homes would be along the creek?
Well, we didn't put the signs right where the house were because we couldn't get right there, you know, the bush now.
Yeah.
But we put the signs close to the road where the,
mm-hmm.
where the wagon's gonna go.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that would be nice.
So we, I remember where they used to live, but I can't remember all the names of their kids, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Just.
Mm-hmm. You'll see a lot here this weekend, and you'll it'll start coming back.
Mm-hmm.
There's quite a few out even tonight, isn't there?
Yeah.
For the first night.
There's a couple of Bellamers here. They're Victor Bellamer and Adlar Bellamer. They would remember way back.
I didn't see a lady get there. See, that one was pretty classy. guess we'll start off the evening here. You can all gather around. Can you all hear? Can you hear? Yeah? Okay. Well, good evening and welcome to St. Madeline Commemoration Days. The weekend will be a time to renew old friendships and share some laughter and talk about old memories, good memories, and make some more memories. Before we start this, the evening, I'd like to just take a few minutes and open the weekend with a prayer. So if we can just bow our heads. I'll read my prayer. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to gather here at St. Madeline. We thank you for the helping hands and the giving hearts that have enabled us to get this weekend together. We ask your blessings on tonight and the whole weekend, Lord. And we know that you feel our happiness as we gathered here. And you'll be with each and every one of us on the way home. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I could go on and on with the thanksgivings. But I'll tell you, it took quite a bit of work to get this together. And we had a lot of help from our local members, as well as help from our neighboring locals and help from our regional office and from our head office. So the weekend here and the whatever you enjoy will be part of all of your hard work. St. Madeline Days started with an idea shortly after the book was commissioned and written, the book written about St. Madeline, Community Without a Town by Ken Zelig. And the past president of the Binscarth local, Pete Nicolishan, was always talking with Joe Venn about getting something going, and we got to get something going. And slowly, the ideas began to form about how we'll get this evening together. And so over the course of 2 years, with a lot of people inputting their ideas, what they'd like to see into it, it came to be here tonight. And we talked to the Archbishop, and he's coming for the special mass, and we received a commemoration plaque that we'll unveil on Sunday. And the name of the weekend, the commemoration, is really a very fitting name for this weekend, because commemoration means to keep in remembrance. And on the bottom line of our plaque that we have on there, Victoria and Angela helped me with a little bit of Cree for that, and it's a very special saying, I guess, for St. Madeline, and it's Kishkishin. Kishkishin. So as we remember St. Madeline, we hope you have a really good time, and I'll hand you over to our president, Yvonne Dumont.
Thank you, Annette. That was Annette Dreilich. I believe she's the chairperson of the Binscarth local, and I understand that Annette, along with the rest of the local members, put in a lot of work to make sure that this event was to take place. I first heard about Sainte Madeleine here in about 5 years ago. I spoke to people like Harry Pelche and Joe Venn and Dave Janai and other people from around here. And I heard about this community that once stood on these grounds. And I looked through the history books that are available in Manitoba and in Canada. And the history of Sainte Madeleine was nowhere to be seen. It was disappearing. The memories, the history that was here only existed in the hearts and minds of the people who lived here during the 1930s. And I thought that it was quite an interesting story, and it was a story that was worth preserving so that it could be a piece of history of your community and how it fits into the Métis as a people, so that it would be there for our children to read and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren and so on. I thought it would be important that we got this history documented and written down so that Sainte Madeleine as a community, the people who lived here, who gathered here, would never be forgotten. So I got together with a gentleman who did some radio work for the CBC, a man by the name of Ken Zelig, and many of you have met him. And I asked him if he would do some interviewing of certain people. And we were lucky enough to interview people like Joe Venn, Louis Pelche, Harry Pelche, Lena Fleury, Agnes Boucher, and I can't remember all the others at this time, but we were able to get their thoughts on a tape recorder and then written down in the form of a book. And now we have a book that's called Sainte Madeleine, A Community Without a Town, that is preserving a very important part of the history of your community of Sainte Madeleine. I thought that was important. Now, I've been asked here this evening, and I'm very honored to do so, although I kind of feel out of place, to talk about Métis history to a group of Métis elders who probably know more about history than I do. But I want to tell you about the things that I've learned in my lifetime from speaking to old people, speaking to elders, about the history of the Métis people. And to look at it from a Métis perspective. And so what I'm going to tell you about the history of the Métis people as in as short a period of time as I can, is basically the Métis history from the Manitoba Métis Federation perspective. And that history that we've been able to learn about is not the history from an Englishman's point of view, and it's not the history from a Frenchman's point of view, but history from a Métis perspective, from a Métis point of view. The Métis were born as a people in the early 1800s, in the late 1700s and the early 1800s. And people referred to them as half-breeds, Métis, Métis. Some people call us Métis. Some people call us Métis. Tabrasala Limichif. À Saint-Laurent, moi, où je viens, on s'appelle Limichif. C'est pas, c'est à l'entour de Sainte-Madeleine, ça s'appelait Limichif, mais non Limichif. Ben non, les Métis, c'est bien que vous savez mieux que moi. Les Métis. But they were born in the early 1800s. They've been called all kinds of names, bad ones and good ones over history. But I remember when I went to school, and as we learned history. We learned it from a Canadian perspective. And there was hardly anything taught to us about the Métis. Hardly anything taught to us about our community. And so one day I got up and I said to my teacher, I think I was in grade 9 at the time, I said, "Teacher, how come we learn everything about history? We learn about Russia, and we learn about Europe, and we learn about the history of China, and we learn about the history of Eastern Canada, but when it comes right down home, we don't learn anything about our own community, about our own history. We don't learn anything about the history of our people." And the teacher said to me, "Where is the center of the world?" Saint-Laurent, at that time, was the community that affected me most directly every day of my life. It was the center of my world. And I'm sure that as you lived here in Sainte-Madeleine, a long time ago that Sainte Madeleine was the center of your world. And to you, maybe Sainte Madeleine is still the center of your world. But yet that history was disappearing. So since that time, I took an interest in talking to people in my community and others about why the people came to live in the area where I lived, in Saint-Laurent. How they got there, where they came from, how they made their living, and so on. And so today, it's something that we're going to do with you. We want to know about your memories about Sainte Madeleine. We want to know about how you got here, how you ended up here. So going back now to the early 1800s, in 1816, the Métis declared themselves to be a people, a nation of people. And they had their own flag, and it wasn't that flag, but it was another flag, that flag over there. That flag was first adopted by the Métis as a nation in 1816. And so they were a people. They weren't just a mixed-blooded people. They weren't just a mix of English and Indian, or Indian and French, or Indian and Scotch. But they were a people in themselves. They were a nation of people, a nationality, every bit as much as the English, the French, the Germans, the Chinese, and so on. And they were the majority in the Red River settlement. There was in 1870, when Manitoba became part of Canada, the total population was about 12,000 people. And about 10,000 of those were Métis. And the Canadian government was going to take over the West. And they sent their surveyors out west. And they were going to subdivide the land the way that they were used to subdividing it. But there was already people living here. The land was already subdivided in different ways, in river lots, not in sections. And so you've probably all heard of the great Métis national hero, Louis Riel, went to meet those surveyors, and he stepped on their surveyor's chain, and he says, "You go no farther until the federal government has dealt, the Canadian government has dealt with the land rights of our people." And they formed a provisional government. And Louis Riel became the president. He wasn't the first president. The first president was John Bruce. He resigned after a few months, and Louis Riel then took over. They negotiated the entry of Manitoba into Confederation, into Canada. And if they hadn't formed that provisional government, there was a chance at that time that Western Canada may have become part of the United States instead of part of Canada. Now, some people might think, well, that would have been better, but for those of us who are nationalists, we believe that the Métis in those days thought that they were better off with Canada rather than the United States. They were better. They thought they were better to have a country from ocean to ocean, rather than from north to south. But the Americans were going to take over. They passed some annexation laws in Minnesota, and they were going to take over Western Canada until the Métis formed their provisional government and insisted that, and they could have went either with the States or with Canada, but they chose to join Canada. Now, in that agreement that they had with Canada, it's called the Manitoba Act. It was the Canadian government guaranteed that the Métis would be able to hang on to their lands, the lands that they occupied at that time. and that was a total of about 200,000 acres along the Red River and the Assiniboine, mostly from Selkirk down to the American border and from the forks of the Red and the Assiniboine down to about around Carmen, I believe it was. And all of that land was to have been set aside for the Métis, 200,000 acres. And over and above that, there was 1.4 million acres of land that was to be set aside for the children of the Métis who lived there at that time for the benefit of their families. And what that did is it placed a constitutional obligation, a legal obligation, on the provincial and federal governments to make sure that that land remained in the hands of the Métis. And instead of making sure that it did, they did the opposite. They did all kinds of things, played all kinds of tricks, and passed all kinds of illegal laws to make sure that that land didn't get in the hands of the Métis. And in the end, less than 15% of that 1.4 million acres ended up in the hands of the Métis. And the Métis from there started dispersing. Some went to because they couldn't hang on to their land, some of them started moving west. Some of them went down to Saskatchewan, to Batoche. Others went south to North Dakota and Walhalla and Dunseith and Belcourt and those areas. And they came back along in the Turtle Mountains and up north and on their way to Saskatchewan. And then the resistance took place in Batoche, and and there was a war over there, and so people started coming north here to Fort Ellis, and I believe they went up to Santa Clara, and they stopped there, and that was the end of what was often referred to as the Métis migration. And so, from what I understand, this is the way that the people of Sainte-Madeleine ended up in Sainte-Madeleine. And maybe you'll be able to straighten me out here later on. And then in 1885, in Batoche, Saskatchewan, again, the federal government wanted to lay a railway track. And again, they wanted to survey, they wanted to go through the Métis land, disregarding their rights. And once again, Louis Riel was called from the United States, and he was asked to lead to negotiate with the federal government to make sure that their land was protected, to make sure that their rights as a people to the land that they were living on was protected. And so they wrote letters to John A. Macdonald, who was the prime minister. And they wrote, and they said that they wanted to negotiate, send somebody down here to talk to us and to assure us that our rights won't be undermined. And instead of sending negotiators, they sent the police. And they sent soldiers. And they sent guns and rifles and bullets. 10,000 soldiers to fight 300 Métis. And the Métis didn't back down. They stood on their land, and they defended it. Many people call it a rebellion, but it wasn't a rebellion. It wasn't the Métis who moved in on the government and tried to overthrow the government, but they stood on their land, they stayed at home, they barricaded themselves, and they took up arms to fight for their land. And so it wasn't a rebellion. That's why I refer to it as a resistance, by resisting the oppression of the mighty Canadian government. And hanged in 1885 in Regina, November 16th of 1885. And from then on, the Métis people were not as strong as they were before. And Louis Riel said that it'd be that the Métis people would sleep for 100 years before they started identifying again, before they started speaking up for their rights. And here we are 125 years later, or 120 years later, and we're gathering here at Sainte Madeleine to talk about a Métis community, to talk about the Métis people, to talk about the memories. And we're still surviving as a nation of people to this day in Canada. The Manitoba Métis Federation is taking the federal government to court. The Manitoba Métis Federation is taking the federal government to court, saying that they neglected their responsibilities in making sure that they protected the rights of the Métis. And on March the 2nd of 1990, the federal government tried to kick us out of the Supreme Court. They tried saying that the Métis had no rights of going to court, that there was no such thing as a Métis nation, but the judges disagreed. They said that the Manitoba Métis Federation and the peoples named on the list of plaintiffs were in fact the proper representatives of the Métis who were promised those lands back in 1870. And so many of your ancestors from the things that we've been able to find, many of your ancestors had received or were supposed to have received lands in the Red River Settlement. And when they were denied that land, they had to move away from there. And some of them went to North Dakota, and they came back to the Turtle Mountains, and they ended up in Sainte Madeleine, where once again they settled, and they had land. And that land was in their name until sometimes during the 1930s, when once again all kinds of games were being played that led to those same people that had lost their land at the Red River Settlement also lost the land here in Sainte Madeleine. And the result was that the community, the church, the school, the houses that were built here no longer exist. The cemetery is the only thing that survived, and I believe that's the foundation to the school over in the other opening over there. So now I'd like to ask you, as people who lived in Sainte Madeleine, who have memories of Sainte Madeleine, to tell us about Sainte Madeleine, to tell us maybe we can start by having somebody telling us about their favorite story of Sainte Madeleine, their favorite memory of Sainte Madeleine. Okay, we have Adlar Bellemeur.
Since about 1928, I can remember. Since about 1928. At that time, we all lived around here and making a fair living. People milk cows, and go out, do some work for the farmers. And they were doing all right. But then I left in 29. After I left, they seemed to be either... They weren't really chased out of here. They were given land to go back to have a home, like, eh? Some of them went into Winnipegosis, some went down to Duck Bay in Camberville, and they didn't like it. They came back. They came back here again. Tom Biscard. And I remember what. Oh, I lived here at that time too. Where they lived. Like Alec Flamand, he lived just west of here, about a mile. And his son-in-law, Charlie Porter.
I don't know much to talk about.
And and friend that I've ever met. I forget his first name. And then my grandfather lived there, Baptiste Fleury, and my dad, and then Jimmy Ledoux, and old Johnny Fleury, Frank Fleury, William Fleury, they all lived along that way. They were making a fair living. But then in 1930, when they changed the government, things went down so low. Well, they had it dry. That was the worst of it, dry. You couldn't keep nothing, couldn't keep any cattle, couldn't keep any horses. That's why that's what the depression was worst about here around here. Oh yeah, I was sad that it was okay. I remember people going out here, they were making a good living. They would go digging roads that time, you know, and there was bounty for everything, anything you killed, like a game, arming thing, but bounty. But since all that bounty's been gone away, well, then it made it hard. Right in Camberville, it's hard right now. There's nothing to do. There's nothing to do. Only bushwork, and not much of it either. That's what I can say about this place here. They were fine.
Thank you. Anybody else want to tell us a version of a story about when they lived here in Sainte Madeleine? Okay, Louis Ledoux.
Well, I'll just tell you a little bit because I was born here in Sainte Madeleine, and we lived here on the seventh year. We lost one of my sister, a little baby, and then right after that, my mother died. They're both buried in here. And we were very, very lonesome. We didn't know what to do. We were made a living anyway. My dad was working. We were all young. We were three of us kids. They all died now. I'm the only one that's left. And we went away from here. We moved away towards Grand View, followed the Indian Trail with two teams. My grandfather was with us at that time too, my dad's dad. And we stayed in Grand View digging Seneca Root and there, try to make it go. From there we went to Camperville, and we see over there my grand uncle. And that's our relation in there, and we feel a little better after we've seen our relation. So we stayed in there for a while, but we could never forget this Sainte Madeleine. This was a place that nobody ever forget. You can tell that by looking at me here today. I'm 80 years old now, I still don't forget this place, and I like it very much. I'm with my grandchild here, Blaine Ledoux. He wants to come back here and make a house. He wants to live here. This is the first time he ever seen it. So after that, I come back in here. I was 15 years old, and then I come back in here. There used to be some dances in here. I worked right around here, around Russell, Silverton, and Ben Scott. Every Saturday, he used to come to a dance in here. We used to fight me and Paul Fleury, and I used to get a licking. And we made friends.
We had pretty good friends, me and Paul Flaherty. So now, we are good friends. And I like Paul, and he likes me too, I guess. Looks like that to me now. So, it's too bad that I was too young, you know. I could maybe save a lot more, because this is a wonderful place, and there's nothing like it in Manitoba, I don't think. Although where I'm living, it's a, we're making a living, but I can't never forget this place. Thank you.
Thank you, Louis. Victoria Janai is going to ask some questions in Cree and maybe ask somebody to tell some stories.
I asked them if they understand what they were supposed to be saying or the questions that were asked. And Alvina said, yes, I understand. So I asked her, well, I said, you have to tell them the story of how you made your living here. And she says, all we ever got was gum. Anybody else want to talk? Kupishwan? Maren?
Can you ask Lena about to tell a story of when she was a little girl and went for her walks?
Hold up.
Lena, can you ask her when she was a little girl and she'd take her walks down that road to Pushe there?
Lena? Kwechi mitano ma kalat svi yen me kwachka pam tena madlen wata to story chach mo yen. I asked Lena to tell us the story of when she was a little girl going out for a walk, but she said, I forgot most of it.
Bring it here anyway. I don't know what you say.
I call it speed and you walk about in a month.
When I seen a white man, I used to run away. I didn't want to take a walk with them. Well, I don't know what to say. I haven't got too much to say.
That story that Lena Drylik and you were talking about that time at your place when I was there. And when somebody went to borrow a dustpan?
Huh?
Somebody went to borrow a saucepan?
Oh, yeah. Oh, Lena Drylik, well, he was young that time. We were all young. So he came at home. His mom sent her to come and borrow a saucepan. So he come at home, he come and ask my mom, my mom, you want to borrow a dustpan. What is he going to do with the dustpan? He want to cook some potatoes. So he went home. My mommy gave a saucepan. She understood what she wanted. Anyway, that's all I can say for now. Thank you. You want to talk?
Thank you so much. Since I was born in Saskatchewan, Welby, Saskatchewan, I met my husband in 1929 at a wedding. And then from there on, as you know, we courted, and then in 1930, I married him, and we settled on this section here, next to the cemetery, on section 1829, range 31. And we lived there for, I'd say, from 30 to 40, that was 10 years. And during those years, he was farming, we had cattle, and we also had the post office, which was a great help to our living. And then I never learned too much Cree then. my grandparents only spoke French to me. And I learned the Cree through the people that I was with, but I cannot speak it fluently. I can understand quite a few words. And, okay. From there on, when we were told in 1940, when they started to evacuate the people from the district, we were told then that we would no longer would have the post office, and we would have to disband as well and try and find another place to go to make a living. So we moved the, I can't remember the section of the valley, but we moved in the valley about 4 miles east of here near St. Lazare. There we lived for 2 years. And then after that, we moved again from there and moved on the Broomfield Place, which we lived there for 40 years. And we moved to, we retired in 1973 and moved to Biscarth. And I have lived there ever since. And 5 years ago, I was unfortunate to lose my husband. And I have led a lonely life since. Thank you.
I don't know really what to say, but I got a little thing to say. Drew was my brother, Drew Bushy, her husband was my brother. He used to live close here, right in the bush here. And then he moved to the valley. I went, we moved with him there. We bought a three-quarter section of land there. And then he moved to Broomfield. Then I stayed down the valley, but it was a bad boy. I lost my quarter, then I had to go away. So we moved to Saskatchewan, Calder. We stayed there for a couple of years. Then we moved to Winnipeg. Since there, we're in Winnipeg since. It's what, 32 years now I'm in Winnipeg. But this Madeline was few people. I know them all as far as that goes. I'm glad to see them here, which I didn't see them for years. But that's all I got to say.
I'd just like to ask you, when you were in St. Madeline, like there was the one store, and when I was driving down with Eva yesterday, putting up some of the signs with Eva Fleury, she was saying that Mr. Boyer, what, Fred Boyer? Fred Boyer, he had the pool room. And other than the store and the pool room for, like, how did you get together and have fun? There was lots of music, I'd imagine. Can you remember a wedding, or do you remember when... how did you get together? There wasn't a hall here to get together like we do now. And I'm just really interested in these things. Now when we have a wedding or a dance, well, we usually get somebody to cater the meal. We go out and we pay somebody $8 a plate to cater it. We have to apply for a liquor license, and we get rent the hall. And then by 1 o'clock at night, everybody's got to get out of the hall. And just like you to tell me how, or tell us here, how the weddings were when you were living in St. Madeline. How did you go about that? Alvina, can you and Eva start?
Somebody's house. Yeah. Well, I don't want to call it. Oh. Well, we would gather some people and go to somebody's house, like Joe Vanna's house or Joe Bushy's house. That's my godfather, Joe Bushy. And my mommy's house, my house was too small. And then we'd meet there, and then we'd gather some people and go, like Jake and them, or fiddle, and every all night long, and in the morning have lunch, go again. Boy, we used to do those things. I'm still going. Thank you.
That's all I can say. You know?
Yeah, you know.
you talk? Right there. Okay. Yeah, my name is Linus Bellamer. I was born about three quarters of miles east of here. I still remember the place. I can still find it. And I went to school here. I went to church here. I got my first communion here, and I was confirmed here. And like they said, I like to know what we used to do for entertainment. Well, we had lots of entertainment. Myself, I liked horses, and I used to ride a lot of horses. I even used to ride steers and then milk cows. And then, we used to play ball in summertime. We never missed a Sunday. We used to play ball. We had a pretty good ball team here. Well, we used to come down, so we had a lot of fun when I was a kid. I used to play with the men, of course. I was only 13, 14, up to 16 years old, I guess. And, but I liked ball, and that's all we had. We never played hockey, but nobody played hockey here, which was too bad. Maybe I would have been a star today, I don't know. But I never had a chance. And as far as the dances, well, we used to play ball till dark, then we had an old fellow by the name of Juno Bess, just south here. Then everybody had a lunch, and then we'd go to his place, and we had lots of fiddlers. Then we'd dance all night there Sunday night. We had a lot of fun. Then for weddings, well, like he said, we'd go to some, whoever got married, that's where we dance. And that'll be about 2 days sometimes, 3 days sometimes. We had a lot of fiddle players. And the good ones I remember was Isadora Venn, Charlie Vermette, Bill Bushy, Gilbert McKenzie. Where is he? Gilbert McKenzie, he's sitting Gilbert Bushy, he's sitting over there. Like my brother Leo, he was the one that used to do a lot of tricks in school. But we used to have a lot of fun anyway. So, and like my dad worked for Robinson most of the time, and then he bought a section of land. You can still see the Spruce Tree just north of here. That's where we were raised. Till my dad died in 1935, and 37 I went to work, and I worked till. I'm still working. I got off work at 4 o'clock today. So I've been retired since 85 from the railroad, but I'm still working for farmers. I was born a farmer, and I'm still a farmer. Thank you.
Thank you. I was born. Oh, yeah, take a show. Le call got to take out a Madeleine. I want his tashta. Chpal?
What do you want to do?
Chat the man that she called because she's the ego there. Lee knows how to take it and she got to make. Yo.
Well, I was born and raised about 3 miles south of here, the east. And I went to school. There was a school here where the cemetery, there was a church there one time. And I first went to school there for a couple of weeks, I guess. I was only around 6, 7 years old. But then it was too far to walk. And then they built the church, I mean the school, another about 1/2 mile south of the old church here, the old cemetery. And I went to school there till off and on for up to about when I was 15, because I had to work in the summertime. I only went to church went to school in the wintertime. But otherwise, I was, as far as I know, my dad moved out to Sainte Madeleine here from west of Winnipeg. Saint-François Xavier was the name of the place. So they moved here. And outside of that, there's a whole lot to say, but it's take too long anyway. Thank you.
Well, I just asked Eva here if she would share with us some memories. Eva Fleury, sister Mary Fleury, is my neighbor in Binscarth, and one day we were over having coffee, and Mary told me a story of how they were raised and some of their family life, and it really touched me. And I just asked Eva here if she could share some of the memories of her sisters and what it means to them now to be together and in and around the area, and just how it all started. So, Eva, could you share us with those?
I don't know what to start. Well, how I remember, I just remember my mom, barely remember her, when one of my brother was sick, and my mom took us upstairs. That's the only time I remember her. And then a month after that, it was my grandfather. We used to live not too far from the school. My grandfather used to live there. And that's where we were, living with them. And he passed away too, a month after. And then we were living with my grandma was looking after us, and my Uncle John Vermette. And after that, we had a little house here, not too far from the church. And my dad was looking after us. There was me, Mary. By then, Charlie went and lived in Saskatchewan with the priests. He was there for 14 years with the priests. And us, we were living with Dad here. And then Dad had to go to work. By that time, Charlie had came back to St. Madeleine, and he was looking after us for a while. And then when Dad went away again to Saskatchewan, Belcarre, Saskatchewan, and he got married down there, and he stayed down there. So we, after that, each of us had to go and live with somebody. So I went to live with the Milmers, my dad's first cousin, that's Lionel's mom and dad. And that's where I lived. And my sister Mary went to live with the Boyers in Welby. They moved to Welby from here. And one of my brother and Charlie had to go to work too, so that's when we were separated. And Della, she never lived with us after mother died. She was adopted by Mrs. Jo Bercier, and she lived with Mrs. Jo Bercier all this time. We never was together till now. Seems like we're lucky that way. We're all in Binscarth. There's me, Della, and Mary together.
And Charlie.
We go to bingo often, but our brother Charlie doesn't like that at all. So that's about them all. I have kids, and they're really nice to me. And adopted kids too, and they're really all nice to me. So I was lucky that way, I guess. That's about all I can say. Okay, thank you.
Well, thanks, Eva. You know, when Mary told me that story there about your family and that, I thought it was so special that it was kind of similar to St. Madeleine, because even though you know, you were separated, your feelings were there for your sisters and your brothers, and they never left you. And the whole community, the way Mary was telling me, the whole community was like that. You know, one family wasn't separate against one family. It was all together, one big community and good friends, and everybody helped each other out in the times when.
So I didn't really know my mother, but my grandma, she was my, still remember her. I'll never forget her.
That's good. Let's see, Alvina? Oh, Myrtle.
Here we go. You're waiting here so patiently.
Just listening. I'm so happy to hear, see everybody here. And I was born in St. Ambrose, but I came to St. Madeleine when I was 2 years old. And I was here till I was 10 years old. Then, but my fondest memories was all these ladies, most of them mostly, I guess, I went to school with in Bellevue School. Yes. And I'm very happy to meet them. And then my memories about the Bellemers, Pat Benamel, Grandpa, and Uncle Adlore, and well, Auntie Matilda here, and my cousin Alice Bushy and her husband, and quite a few that we are related to. And St. Madeleine was a nice place to live. People were very friendly. They visited each other in their homes, and they told stories. They named them les contes. And they used to visit each other for the evening from house to house. And that's the way we passed the time. And I heard about the dances, but I was too young. But my parents attended the dances, and all my uncles, and everybody had a good time. Nobody was lonely in St. Madeleine. It was a nice place to live, a very good place. No, I don't remember. I used to be scary stories, and I used to be so scared. And I noticed that I have a cousin here that usually came from St. Ambrose to visit my mom and dad, was R.V. Ducharme. And he used to come. He's here now. And we used to play ball and everything. All the children were together.
I hear you're a good singer in French. Can you sing?
Oh, I can't sing. I've never sang in my life. I'm yeah. Sorry to say.
You used to sing in French when we were in Camperville.
Yeah.
You came there with your dad.
Yeah.
You used to sing French.
Yeah, I forgot all those things because I brought up all my
What's
children.
Your sister?
And sister Rita and Irene.
Irene.
Yeah, Irene and brother George that passed away a year ago last March. He was buried in Alberta, but they brought him here this spring and buried back St. Madeleine Cemetery. Yeah, and they transferred his remains. And I'm happy to know that they done that for the family. And I guess that's about all I can say. Is I'd like to thank Mr. DeMont for his wonderful speech, and. I got my son John. He's vice president of Métis Federation in Southwest Region. And thanks to Mr. Zelik, I know him. I had an interview with him, and you had an interview with my husband, Edmund. Yeah, he's not here today. He's not feeling too good. So I told him I'd pray to the Lord for him to get better. Yeah, thank you.
Oh, Josephine, you can't sit there quiet for too long. You have some very, very lot of memories to share with
that
us.
Much.
No,
the
no,
last
no.
Time the last thing I remember when I was digging snickeroots here. I used to dig all week and then go to Ben's Garden and sell them for 15 cents a pound.
What would you buy with your 15 cents a pound?
Groceries for the week.
Groceries.
Yeah. And then we, on weekends, we used to go to dances from one house to the other. And then we used to, when we had a birthday, they'd make a cake, eh? We had a dance there. And everybody had to put a nickel in the cake. The one that eats the nickel had to make the next dance. We did that all week. Yeah, and then. We used to go. I used to go to church here every Sunday.
How old were you when you're like when you're digging the Sinicroot and buying the groceries and all that?
Well, I was already married then.
Oh.
Yeah.
Geez.
So when you're digging Sinakrut, who had your kids?
Oh, and my kids. I didn't have no. No, I wasn't married. No, I'm sorry. Then the first time I was married after dope, and I still digging Sinakrut then. Yeah, but when I had my kids, well, my mother just kept them.
Oh, yeah.
I stayed with my mother for quite a while.
So everyone was always helping
each other. Yeah, yeah. I used to babysit for my mother, too, and then she kept my kids, too. Yeah, so until I started going out with Joe then, and I stayed with him. I lived with him for about 50, 60 years, I guess, 50 years. Yeah.
Do you care to tell us anything about Joe?
Oh, well, he was the...
Could you tell us something about Joe?
Well, yeah, he used to do some carpenter work, and then he used to work all the time and then bring food for the house on weekends.
Did you guys live here right until 1940?
Until 39 when we moved from here.
Did you and Joel live in St. Madeline right until the PFRA came in?
Yeah, I had kids then. Yeah, then we moved to Birtle over there.
When you say like you moved to Birtle, you moved your belongings and that, but your house stayed here. What happened to your house after?
Well, we each had log houses here, eh? When they push us out of here, well, we had to go somewhere else. That's when we moved close to Birtle.
Whatever.
In the CPR house or something.
Did you used to come back to visit St.
There was nobody. We all, the place we used to go and visit after that, when this Fulliard Town and Selby Town, that's where they all moved. Eh?
Oh.
So we used to get together there.
Whatever happened to your log house here?
The house? I can't remember. They, from what I heard, they teared them all down and burned them or whatever.
Oh.
Yeah, that's what I was told anyway. So, and up to now, well, now I'm living in our folks' home. I don't dance anymore. Just once in a while.
Do you remember some stories we can make Alvina tell? Some funny stories we can make Alvina tell?
I can make what?
Can you tell us some, get Alvina to tell us some stories?
Some stories?
Yeah.
Well, probably she remembers some there. She remembers. I used to live with John's mom when I had my first kid. I used to live with them, with her mother and her dad.
Oh.
Yeah, for quite a while. I lived there for about a year, I guess.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah. That was before I had three kids, before I went stayed with Joe. Eh?
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, we stayed together.
Long time.
Eh? Long time, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, so that's about it, I guess.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah,
you're welcome. Who else would like down here?
Here, I gotta get up because my knees are sore.
Hello, this is a great gathering. It's nice to be here. I'm the second century of the Fleuries. I've just turned 65 years old. I was born in this Saint Madeleine myself in March 1925, March 30th. So I've seen a lot. I remember the things that happened here. As a kid, I went to school myself here for a while. And I think I lived here till I was about 7 years old. And we moved out of here, and my dad always worked for the farmers, and I became one of them too. Worked for a living on the farm for a good number of years. And I remember the school that was there. And I think we moved out of here sometime in the early 30s. I think about 1939 that I remember of, that we moved out of here. We moved to just east of Benscarth, about 2 miles, is where my dad, that's where we made a home. And that I remember very well. And I remember the people that lived here. I remember About 30 families living here as a kid. And I know all the young fellows that's here today that grew up with me, most of them were born here. And we did have people here were poor them days, but I can say everybody was happy and everybody had a lot to eat. I remember in the hungry 30s when my dad was working on the farm for $5 a week, just about 10 miles out of here, east of here, northeast of here. And I left there myself in 1953 from that same farm. And we were a big family. There was 11 of us kids. And most of us, the oldest ones, like my two sisters and I, never got much schooling. And my younger brothers and sisters got schooling because we were able to, down here, a place where Joe Boucher was farming, the sons are farming there now. I remember going to school there in the early 40s. I went to school myself there for about 2 years and got as high as grade 2. And at that time, I was about 12 years old, and the teacher told me I was getting too smart, I had to leave. So I left. But like I say, the people here didn't have too much. But I remember a lot of people had dog teams here. And Lionel talked about they used to have ball here every Sunday. And I remember that very well. And then we used to pitch horseshoe. Everybody had a great time. And then after the baseball, the ball was over, we'd all gather and we'd go to someone's house and party. Somebody would grab a violin, someone would grab a guitar, and then we all learned how to dance. I learned how to dance when I was 8 years old. And today I just try to dance. And I remember a lot of good things about this place myself. Because people were friendly. And furthermore, we learned to respect each other. I don't know, today that's all dying out. The kids got together with the older people. The older people took the kids and tried to teach us manners and how to respect our older people. Thank you very much. And there was a lot going here, even though the people didn't have much, but they all cared. They all cared and they shared. And I was hoping to hear that from some of the older people here today. I like myself, like I said, I don't remember too much, but I remember leaving here about 1937. That I remember very well. You know, and like I say, nobody had much money. But everybody lived good and they lived happy. And they all shared together. And I'm hoping in the future that will happen here. I think we're all scattered all over the place. I know when we left here, we were very fortunate that my dad, the farmer that he worked for all his life, gave us a house and a place to live. And my dad worked there for a good number of years, and I became a part of that same farmer myself. I worked there.